We unfortunately everything that start have to finish as well, and today we have our last day of the course, but that's not means the least. We are, and I'm very happy to have today Jan-Yves Tinnevelt here to give us a presentation on tracking, that I think his favorite tool. And I just want to give a little bit of background about Jan-Yves. He is initially a physicist, I guess, but I think he has done a lot of biophysics and a lot of cell biology later, but including in his PhD and his postdoc, where I didn't know that when you did your postdoc in the Max Planck, you actually there already have founded an image processing facility or image processing analysis facility already at 2007. That means that you are quite pioneer in general for the creation of image analysis facilities. You decide to embrace, not to continue it into the PI career and becoming a professor or something like this. You decide to be a facility engineer, and then you start working with our friend Spencer Short in France, in Paris, in the Pasteur Institute, where you still are now. But now you are the head of your own facility, that is the bioimaging analysis facility. And as I say, you today will talk about tracking cells, and that's more or less where you have done as well on terms of developing, because you have not only helped people in the facility and solving easy things, but you have also developed a lot of tools that many, many people is using, like TrackMate, for the ones have used a lot of these. And of course, the ones I love the more, especially for the names, Mammoth and Mastodont. Once you want to go and really track in big data, because now we are not just doing single particle tracking, a small one, but we also want to do in a really big data. And we are very happy that you are here today and that you join us for this open lecture, and the stage is yours, Jan-Yves. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Julia, for this very kind introduction. Now, indeed, my name is Jean-Yves Tinnevelt. I work in a small facility in the Institut Pasteur dedicated to image analysis. And so we are a facility, so we take projects and we help you doing these projects. Now, just very quickly, we are part of a larger infrastructure, national infrastructure called France Bioimaging, that you can access yourself if you ever need to access specialized microscope or specialized expertise, including, and we will develop that image analysis. So briefly, if this is interesting to you, you know, just visit these two addresses. If you need a collaboration on image analysis and I in the neighborhood, we would be happy to help. I think that we had the chance to discuss that with Julia in the beginning. You are as well advanced as us in Sweden, even more advanced when it comes to image analysis. Now, nonetheless, just for the next 30 minutes, Rafa asked me to actually make a small introductory lecture on tracking and its use for smart microscopy. As a full disclaimer, the projects I do in the facility, so we don't do smart microscopy. And so actually I took in the second part, after a very, very basic, very introductory part on what is tracking itself, I took three examples for smart microscopy, not what I'm doing, but the one that I like very much. So these are people I have a chance to talk to, setup I have a chance to visit, and case studies on C. elegans, because I like C. elegans. So it's going to be very relaxed, very introductory. So don't hesitate to interrupt on everything, because it's meant to be basic. So in a quick introduction to tracking, we will in the next 10, 15 minutes just review what is tracking. And my goal in this is to actually give you the key to understand how does a tracking algorithm work, so that you can use it for your project and decide what's important and how to optimize also your experiment so that tracking works. And so basically, why, if we ask what is tracking, it's not super complicated. Now, in most cases, not all cases, tracking is made of two parts. So we work with actually a sequence of images, time lapses, and in each time point, we have actually a collection of objects. Or here there would be Charlie Brown in a baseball. And the goal of tracking is actually simply to say, hey, I have a baseball here, a baseball here, and a baseball here. This is actually the same object over time. And so tracking is about that. The results of tracking is propagating the identity of objects over the sequence of frame. Classically, almost all tracking algorithms works in two parts. The first one is the detection, where you actually you take all frame, all time points, independently from one another, and then you will actually detect the objects that are here. And as the output of this part, you just have a collection of objects. And in the second step, you want to actually link this object and say, for instance, this object and this object, they are the same in different frames. So you want to link them so that you build tracks. And so then the output of tracking this time is actually tracks where you propagate the identity of objects across time. Now, I told you, you know, almost all tracking algorithms work like this, not all of them. I will just focus on this because I have no time to go really deep actually. But in life science, the situation is a bit more complex than, you know, with peanuts, a baseball, and Charlie Brown, because most of the time, the objects we are trying to track, they're undistinguishable, sorry about that. So that's an example, you know, from a movie by Kotamura and colleague, where he's actually tracking, you know, the microtubule tips. And it's a beautiful movie, but if I stop it, well, I cannot stop it, but never mind. You will see that, you know, each of these objects here is really looking like all the other ones. So unlike Charlie Brown and Peanuts, they don't have like features or face that would allow us to identify them separately from each other. So when we're going to perform tracking, automated tracking with actually algorithms and mathematics, we have to rely on other techniques to actually link these objects, which is going to make it a bit more difficult. And so, now, how does a tracking algorithm work? In the following minutes, I'm just going to have this story example. You know, here you have like four cells, they've already been detected, and we want to track them. So we have four cells in the first time point, four cells in the second time point, and we want to link them. And we will see how tracking algorithms are built and try to see that. And so linking is just about that. You create a link from one object to another, and you say, okay, the object D1 actually is the object D2, but just in another frame, or the object B2. Now, in our case, intuitively, like we see that, you know, this is most likely a good link and this is most likely a bad link, right? For this to be the same cell from one frame to another, the cell would have to jump a lot, and actually the other two cells up there would have to permute its positions. So we would like to say that intuitively, we are a priori knowledge, this is a bad link. And this is not good enough. Since we want to have a tracking algorithm, we need to find a way to formulate that mathematically, kind of. And so one possibility is to actually assign to each link a cost, for instance. Now, what is the cost? We will see that in a moment. But for instance, you know, I could say that the cost for this link to be the true link is 2.5, and the cost for this link to be the true link is 43, which is much higher. And then tracking would be actually finding the link with the minimal cost. Now, costs are not arbitrary, right? You want to build them in a way that makes sense. And in this case, if you go to work with costs, actually cost functions are like heuristics, something that you build like by putting plenty of ingredients in a big stew, for instance. And what you could say is that you could, hey, I'm going to build a cost function that is large, is the displacement, you know, from the target cell to the candidate cell is very large. And so here you would penalize like unfeasible links, for instance, where a cell would teleport across the field of view, which is not good. Or for instance, another possibility that you could compose the cost by using the object fluorescence intensity. If you know that, for instance, your object will not change in intensity over time, you may want to penalize actually linking objects where the fluorescence change a lot, because this is unlikely to be the same object. Or another possibility is that, let's say that you have a motion model that you know, for instance, that your object move with a constant velocity, almost in a straight line, like when they're transported around microtubules, for instance. And you can say, hey, I'm going to make a cost which is very high if the position of the object deviates from the position I can infer from the previous ones. Right? And so you mix that together and you create a cost function that will actually assign and scalar positive real value to these links. And so this construction, actually what it does, it's a mathematical way of encoding your a priori knowledge about the biology. What do you know about your experiment? And so your a priori knowledge is, you know, my object doesn't change size. My object doesn't move faster than a certain speed, and so on and so on. And so you put this in a cost function and you have like this. Now here, I just spoke about, you know, one way of estimating, you know, the goodness or badness of links, but you could also, instead of using cost, you could work in probabilistic or Bayesian frameworks and say, no, we will not speak about cost, but about probability, and derive them based on motility models, for instance. Again, I don't have much time to speak about that. So in our case, we are not trying to link one object versus the others, right? We want to have a good accuracy on tracking. So what we are trying to do is actually link multiple objects to multiple candidates. And the way to do that is not much more complicated, right? You actually collect hypotheses. And for instance, you would say in the first hypothesis, all my objects would link to all these objects via these four links. You know, that's one configuration. Or one assignment, a set of links, you will meet this sometimes in publication, it's called an assignment. And so each of these links would have a certain cost. And then you say, okay, that's an hypothesis, I'm gonna try a new one, for instance, and then, you know, D1 would link to this one, C1 to this one, etc., etc. And so that's another cost, and that's another hypothesis. Now then, you're not trying to find the link with the minimal cost, now you're trying to find the assignment or the hypothesis with the minimal cost. And then you need to combine them, right? And you can combine them, for instance, simply summing, you know, all the cost of individual links, and that would be the cost of the assignment. In that case, tracking is about finding the assignment with the minimal total cost. Now, there's quite some gap here, right? So this means that the results of tracking, so what we will suppose to be the true trajectories of particles, is determined by, you know, finding the minimal of this cost. Then it's really important that, you know, the cost function you choose, it must represent the reality really well, your a priori knowledge and the biology really well. And so that's why it's important to know that, right? What your tracking algorithms use as cost function, because it's gonna have a huge impact on the result. This is, you know, I've just in my toy example just been comparing two hypotheses, right? I can tell you right now the cost I've been playing with are just based on the distance. And so the best so far is this one because that's the one which has the lowest cost. But in reality, like when you're writing a tracking algorithm, you need to compare all hypotheses, that is all the possible combination, right? So there's going to be a lot of hypotheses to test. Also, if you want to improve the tracking accuracy, what you need to do is not only consider, you know, linking from one frame to another, but actually linking across several time points, or ideally all the time points of this movie. For instance, one of the, that's not exactly a link, but one of the possibility across four frames would be this cell to become this one, and this one, or this one. And that's just, you know, for one cell across four time points. And then there are all possible combinations of that you need to test and to find the optimal combination and so on. And so then you're facing what's called combinatorial explosion, right? There's so many possibilities, so many hypotheses to test that in practice, computationally, the problem is unfeasible, untractable as soon as you have like hundreds of thousands of cells across hundreds of time points, which is what matters in biology nowadays. And so most tracking algorithms, because this is unfeasible, and because the duration of PhD is limited to, they use various approximations that differ from one tracking algorithm to another. And of course, ideally, this approximation would have zero impact on the result, but they do have. And you know, this is why sometimes tracking results sometimes depend on the algorithm you pick. So it's important to know what algorithm you use and actually to pick the one that fits your biology. Now again, I'm sorry, I don't have much time to speak about the best algorithms to give you a classification, but fortunately, there's a very good paper that was out in 2014 that actually went and compared all, if not most, of the existing tracking algorithms used in life science and actually ranked them by performance in case of different scenarios. And so in that case, to assess this, the performance of tracking algorithm, what they did was to simulate images and the movement of particles. And so they knew what was the ground truth. And so in our case, they sent us the image and we had to run, you know, our own algorithms, give them the results. And they say, okay, you achieve like 50% accuracy or something like this. And the paper was quite thorough in comparison, like compared like four different scenarios, like different kind of objects, vesicle, receptors, 2D, 3D, moving continuously, diffusing or switching motions and so on. They also compared the impact on image quality, like when you move to a very low SNR, single noise, two noise ratio to a very high SNR, and also the density of objects. But of course, intuitively, you understand that tracking is going to be easier in this case than in this case. And what can we learn from this work? The first one is a good news for algorithmists and bad news for users. I'm going to read it. Our results indicate that at present, there's no universally best method for particle tracking. Like meaning that, you know, there must be several tracking algorithms. There's not one tracking algorithm that's good for everything. And you need to pick the right one and to know what makes it fit for the others. I suggest, you know, we just try to very quickly review the more detailed results on that. What can we learn on this? And so the output of this tracking challenge was the following. It's plenty of curves like this. Each of these curves represents one tracking algorithm. And what you see on the y-axis is actually a score. In that case, I just pick one. It's the Jacquard index for track similarity. Again, no time to go into detail, but it represents how accurate is the tracking. So if you have an alpha value of one, it means that you managed to reproduce the ground truth. And a score of zero means you're totally off. And so for us analysts, this kind of curve is super important because they give us a baseline, right? What can you expect? And sometimes you have to manage the expectation of the biologist to ask you for help. And he says, you know, I have a very low signal to noise ratio. What can I expect for tracking accuracy? And we say, well, probably not 100%. And so these curves, they exist for all scenario, all density, and in the x-axis, they actually tune the image quality. Now, what can we learn? The first thing we see is kind of the obvious, like when you increase the density, the tracking accuracy goes down. It's very hard to track objects that are clumped together, that overlap or something like this. But the impact is incredibly high. Basically, when you move to low density to high density, you divide the tracking accuracy by a factor of two, right? Which is huge. I want to point out that, you know, even in the best situation, high image quality, low density, best tracking algorithms, you never get 100% accuracy. And so tracking is hard. It's very hard. Now, this is for density, but then if we move to actually image quality, it's even worse. If you move to a very high signal to noise ratio to the lowest one, signal to noise ratio of one means that the object amplitude has the same amplitude that of the noise. You completely destroy your tracking accuracy. You see, you divide it by 10. With a signal to noise ratio of one, you wouldn't do like tracking, you wouldn't do experiments. I think that's what's interesting is what happened here with the signal to noise ratio of two. This is where we like most realistic imaging experiments happen. And you see here that, you know, that there's quite a range here. So this is where the difference from one method to another play. A bit surprising, but if you think so, not so much, is that the tracking algorithm is important, but not so important. Like you see, if I go from the worst case to the base case scenario, I only move by 20%, so I expected more. As I said, you know, the talent of tracking algorithms, they happen here at low signal to noise ratio. And so the main conclusion of this part is this, paradoxically, right? You need to know about your tracking algorithm. You need to pick the right one. But keep in mind that you can actually optimize your imaging experiment for tracking. And of course, you know, by tuning the image quality, by actually optimizing the image acquisitions, but also by the preparation of sample when possible. For instance, if you move to low density, tracking becomes easier and tracking accuracy becomes better. That would be the ideal. Voilà, that's all I wanted to say actually for this very basic tracking introductions. Now I'm supposed to show you how it can be used into a smart microscopy setup. And you will see that unfortunately for now, it's not so useful. Rafa, you tell me, do you want to ask questions now or do we do it at the end?
No, the best is at the end, don't worry.
Okay, so I told you I don't unfortunately do smart microscopy myself for now. So I picked three examples, maybe not the most important, the most relevant, simply the one either I could talk to the people, visit the setup, or I like the elegance. And I tried to just to show you what can we learn from this. So I would like to start with what I think is probably the first smart microscopy experiment. It's the lab of Howard Berg in Harvard. And I started with this paper, which is 40 years ago. 40 years old, sorry, tracking actually bacteria. And this paper, you see, it's a one-author paper. It proposes a setup that can actually track bacteria, in particular Escherichia coli. So Professor Berg is super interested, as you probably know, by the motility of bacteria. And he says that so far, all the studies have been biased because at the time, the microscope, they had a very small field of view. So bacteria are tiny objects, so you need high magnification. And high magnification means small field of view. And so they were leaving the field of view and says, we are condemned to only study the ones that are immobile. And he says, it's good to keep them, to follow them in XY, but also in Z, because they don't stick to the slide, right? They move in Z, and they leave focus as soon as possible. And so he devised this machine. So in the year, like 40 years ago, and he used dark field microscopy. I think that with this paper, dark field phase contrast microscopy. With a decent objective, you get this kind of image. So that's not an image from the paper, it's from a subsequent paper. But as you notice, in this optical configuration, the bacteria are very bright over a gray background. And so Mr. Berg thought of exploiting this fact into a setup. You see, that would be the microscope, and that would be the smart microscopy setup. And if you notice, there's zero camera, zero computer, it's pure electronic. And his idea was to say, look, if I have something bright, I can put it in the center of the field of view. And let's look at the x-axis. With this device, he managed to put two photoreceptors there, slightly off the center, x1 and x2. And so when the bacteria is exactly at the center, x1 and x2 receive the same amount of light, which is, these two signals are then differentiated and then used to control the X position of the stage. And so if the bacteria is exactly at the center, the stage will not move. As soon as the bacteria move towards X1, X1 will receive more light, X2 less light. And now the difference between the two will generate a positive signal that can be processed to actually move the stage. And so with the difference in voltage, they drive actually the stage in X, Y, and Z, actually six photoreceptors that you see here. And this worked. I could not help but quoting from the paper, the scene through the binocular is extraordinary and says, the bacteria stay immobile in the field. So how do you measure actually the bacteria trajectory in that case? Well, you simply read the voltage from the stage. So you don't measure in effect the position of the bacteria, but the position of the stage over time. You get this kind of curve. At the time, there was no computer. So the signal you see here is actually picture or snapshot of what's on the oscilloscope. And this work actually spent a huge literature. So it's followed by 189 articles on the same subject only by the lab of Professor Berg, among other questions. And with that, and the progress he made after that, he was able to dissect the molecular basis for chemotaxis, for motility, and so on. And probably this book, you probably know it's a fantastic book, Random Works in Biology. So it's really huge. So in that case, that was that. Like the smart microscopy was used to actually track fast-moving objects. Now, fast forward in time now, I would like to speak a little bit of its impact of smart microscopy, not in bacteriology, but in neuroscience. And C. elegans, using C. elegans. Now, C. elegans is, just, probably know better than me, it's a fantastic sample, even for a physicist. all the development of C. elegans mosaic super stereotypical. You can compare one individual to another. It's going to be the same. It's great. And on top of that, you know, the cell is exactly in the same number, same time, same position for every single individual. Consequence of that, that we know that there's 302 neurons in a hermaphrodite C. elegans, and we have the wire diagram for all of that. And so this allows us to actually probe the genetic basis of behavior. Now, in our case, the behavior of a C. elegans, it's going to be, you know, the motility, where does it go, and also the shape, you know, what kind of shape the C. elegans takes to move there. And so for this, we need to build some behavioral assay, you know, something that can measure this, you know, shape and trajectory of the C. elegans. In our case, as always, there's always these two factors. We want to measure the shape, so we need to have high magnification, but we also want to follow the locomotion over a long time of C. elegans, so we need a large field of view. Now, this is, you know, opposite requirements, and there comes smart microscopy. So the first setup that allows you to do that is the one from the Wong lab in 2013. And if you see, the conceptually it's very simple. You just take, you know, a stage and you put it on a stereo microscope equipped with a camera, and you have now software. So it's not pure electronic anymore. Everything is controlled by a computer, the camera driving the stage and the image analysis. Everything is computerized now. I mention it because such a setup actually is supported commercially. So you can reproduce that very quickly in your lab. There's also other versions about that. And so you might want to say that, you know, the tracking is very complicated, but actually it's not. The tracking of the object, because I hope you didn't see that. The segmentation is very simple because the imaging acquisition is very constrained. So you always have the objective and the optical configuration so that, you know, the worm is always black on a gray background. And so you can actually segment the threshold very quick, very simply. And then to get this position, simply take the center of mass and make sure that, you know, the stage is moved so that the center of mass is in the center of you. And you can do that, you know, at one frame per second. If you just have one worm per field, it works, and you're going to be fine with that. Now, this gives the output, again, you tend tracking the position of the stage, not so much of the worm, but you get this. You can, for instance, follow the trajectory of the worm centroid, but since you have the shape, you can also follow, you know, where what the nose does. It's super important for C. elegans. You know, if you have seen this movement pattern, you know that wild type, they have this scanning behavior of the head that you can see here. And then you can start playing with mutants. Now, for instance, that's uncoordinated 9 mutants. Now you see that, you know, the trajectory, but in particular the movement of the head is very different from this one. Another setup I would like to talk about is this one coming from the Schaeffer lab in the same year. Basically, it's the same, but there's a big difference. In that case, we are not moving the sample, but the microscope of the image is not so much, doesn't look like a microscope, but it is a microscope. The microscope itself is actually on the stage. So you move the microscope. Now, do you know why it's so important? You have to think that, you know, the lab of Bill Schaeffer was super interested in actually pulling out the genes that were important for, let's say, proprioception and the mechanosensor of the C. elegans. And he supposed that, you know, when you move the stage, the worm itself would be subjected to small acceleration and small deceleration. You know, when the stage moved, trying to put it in place, the worms were actually subjected to acceleration that could possibly trigger, you know, the mechanosensors. Most likely, back of the envelope calculation, probably the effect of this acceleration is probably peanuts or very negligible. But they didn't want to take any risk that would introduce a bias across, you know, mutants or something like this. And so they have this setup where all the worms are exactly in the same conditions, whether they move or not, they never move. Like they are fixed and the camera moves around. And this lab was able to build like the building a database. That's this paper from Nature Metal 2013, where they follow again the shape and the locomotion of the worms. And what I told you about, you know, not moving the stage is important. Look at that. This one is such a runner, and if we would move it like every second or so, it would be shaped at something like this. And so this, in that case, this configuration of microscopy allow you to have no bias even for fast movements. But again, you know, the image analysis part is very simple because we just have one object. This setup allowed them actually to get this, you know, fingerprint of mutants using various tracking metrics. And thus this sentence was able to identify TRPA, the role, sorry, of TRPA2, a mechanosensitive channel in cryoceptions. That's a personal, particularly interesting account. I want to conclude this, this small talk by using, you know, extreme opposite, and now I have a system which is super complex, super complicated. Here, the challenge associated to actually tracking the object was that we are looking at a mouse embryo in total imaging. So we're imaging everything. That's a work by Katie McDowell and colleague in the lab of Philip Keller in Janelia Farm. And so here, the challenge is that we have such a large sample and it grows over time, right? Its position is not fixed. So everything happens. It drifts, it grows in one direction, and it's imaging this beast is super complicated. You want to image them over 2 full days, and you want to actually retain cell resolution. So you still want to be able to distinguish single cells in that. And so there's no other way than to do smart microscopy, but at such a level, which I was very, very, very impressed. And so the challenge I just told you are summarized in this paper, right? If you don't use smart microscopy, the embryo drifts out of focus very quickly and the quality degrades because as it grows, the optical quality changes as well. And so they devised this setup, and that's my photograph, but the system was already over. And this doesn't pay homage or tribute to the huge amount of work and effort that was put in such a complicated but great setup. And was able to do that, not only to actually keep the sample in focus, but you know, able to deal with the fact that it grows in size and that the optical property change. And so again, because we just have one object, the image analysis part is not super complicated, at least for the tracking. Like tracking the specimen, as you see, is not super complicated. They simply take the centroid and they correct X, Y, and Z position to do that. In the case of actually keeping the full sample in within the field of view as it grows, like measuring the sample volume, it's a bit more complicated. Just you need to correct for background intent threshold, but still okay. But beyond that, I'm not going to speak about that in details. Is that they made plenty of, let's say, tweak to actually change, adapt the property of the optical illumination system just to correct for aberrations that would appear across time. And so for this, they needed to measure the image quality over several planes inside the sample to do that. Now here, the challenge is that, contrary to, you know, to the bacteria of Mr. Berg, where we just X, Y, Z coordinate over time, here we're dealing with a huge amount of data. And so the image analysis you perform here must be able to be done within the frame interval. And the objective was to acquire 2 colors within 5 minutes interval. So everything you do smart microscopy must be quicker than that. In the paper, you can find this, like hidden the material metals every 3 minutes. So they managed to do that. This kind of means that if we ever want to go quicker than that, it's going to be very difficult, I presume. It's also meaning too, it's a fairly complicated system. It's going to be a challenge to actually reproduce it. And unfortunately, I don't see another way to image that, to do otherwise with another microscope. So that's one of the challenges of complexity in microscopy setup. So I'm going to conclude now. As you see, you know, the tracking algorithm used in smart microscopy, they're fairly simple compared to, you know, even my super simple introduction. The main reason for that is that Most of the time in smart microscopy setup, when you track an object, people have managed to only have one object in interest in the field of view. Enfin, that's not exactly true. If we go back to the Berg paper, it says, you know, at some point, the oscilloscope seems to be dead. It doesn't move. It's because the bacterium collided with the one that was not swimming and the microscope elected to follow that one instead. And so probably the usage, you know, of this good tracking algorithms would have helped actually identifying the correct bacterium and follow it over time. I will conclude here. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much, Rafa and Julia, for your kind invitation. I need to thank Joanna Pilvanainen and Guillaume Jacquemet. The image you've seen in the first part are from them. Katie McDowell, now in MRC Lab, when she welcomed him in Janelia and introduced me to his beautiful setup. And you know, this is the brave engineers that work with me in the Institut Pasteur in the Image Analysis Hub. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Yang-Yi. Please, there is some people that have the hang on. Could you please put the QA, the question in the QA? Thank you.
And then I will go over, I will collect a few questions together because I have noticed that many people are interested in what have been the advances in the cost functions. So you mentioned already some things like position, speed, direction, and so on. But also they are wondering what happens if you have perhaps more complicated objects and if you can also use the how the object looks like and and this type of thing. So what have been the recent advances in these cost functions?
You know, there's something I didn't speak about. The recent advance now is actually the use of deep learning, including in tracking. Right. And this paper was written before the advent of deep learning in life science and doesn't speak about it. When it comes to actually building cost functions, for instance, there's a couple of classical means we know. For instance, if you have Brownian motion, you can prove mathematically that the best cost function is simply to use the distance squared. And so that will be able to retrieve the Brownian motion. There was also the first work by the lab of Ivo Spalzarini, where he combined that with actually the distance squared. They add a term to actually penalize for difference in intensity and intensity distribution within objects. And with that, in this challenge I showed you, he was able to shine. And he showed that, you know, putting more a priori knowledge in the cost function really improved the tracking accuracy. It's kind of logical, right? The more you know, the more you put into the algorithms, the better is the accuracy. And of course, that's about like writing good tracking algorithms is about exploiting a priori knowledge the best you can.
Perfect. And then another, we had a couple of questions regarding to a little bit what you mentioned already, which is the use of machine learning. So some people have been wondering if, for example, there has been the use of instance segmentation to improve the initial part, so object detection in crowded environments. And then the second part is that if machine learning can help also to create better links. For example, is it possible to use machine learning to learn from manually annotated links and so on? Or what are the possibilities there?
Right. So when it comes to actually the detection part, machine learning can really help. So what you see here is actually an example of tracking with Stardist. Stardist is an algorithm that's able to segment objects and separate them when they are very close or touching each other, which is a crux in image analysis. And it's very good at that. Now there's plenty of others. It just happened to be the one on this picture. And so yes, of course, we expect that this will improve tracking, in particular where you have dense objects, like when they're close, when they're touching. Because there's nothing worse than, you know, two objects being close and being mistaken for a single one that is big. And so we expect that deep learning will help us with that. When it comes to the use of deep learning to predict better links, here I do not know. And it's a very good question. I would like really to spend time actually running that challenge and metrics just to know that. Because typically you use deep learning to encode complex motility behavior that you could not describe by a function, for instance. or distribute a known distribution, right? Deep learning is good at that. You kind of train it and say, this is how things are, this is how things are, and you can reproduce that. But in the case of tracking, particularly in organelle tracking, we know the motility functions of objects. Like, you know, we know exactly what happens when something diffuses, or we know exactly what happens when something is transported. And the question is that, can deep learning still improve on this exact knowledge we have? And so this I don't know, and I'm very curious to know. And so if you know the answer, if you know a way to have the answer, like, I'd like to offer you a beer and listen to you.
Excellent. So I also go for that beer session. So thank you very much, Yaniv. The panelists, do we have any questions from the panelists before we close?
I would like to ask a question if possible.
Go ahead.
So if you know, there's a lot of tracking tools out there. You have been involved in a couple of them in the development. And they typically output this kind of tracking information, length, position, speed, acceleration, and so on. If I was a beginner and I wanted to, for example, differentiate different phenotypes, what would you recommend to me? What software, what kind of software libraries, programming languages, what would be a good start to dive into this direction, post-processing tracking data?
Just to get started with tracking?
No, I mean, tracking I can do. There's cool software for that. But if I want to further analyze tracking data, what would you recommend to dive into?
So the output of tracking is tracks, right? That's a collection of links through a collection of objects. But that's not what it's interesting to biology. They want to know like the speed, where things go, and so on, like biologically relevant metrics. And so here, I would say that, you know, there are tools that emerging or frameworks in Python, for instance, that can do track analysis. But every time, you know, this is something where you would actually do scripting. You move to data analysis, and there's, I think, very few software where you can just click on a button to get an answer. And so I think you had Christina Ulitina in the beginning of this course. I think she's the author of a tracking tool in Python, and probably you can extend that to do track analysis. After that, there's a couple of them in MATLAB, which is still, you know, a scientific programming language. I know the competition is very good, but it's not dead yet. And so I don't have a good answer for you beside actually, you know, learning a scripting language in Python or MATLAB.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Perfect, Yaniv. So I think we will close the Q&A. I just want to tell to everybody that put a question and perhaps the answer, you didn't hear an answer. We will come back to you shortly via email or otherwise. Julia, I leave it up to you for the closing remarks.
Yep. Thank you very much. I wanted to also thank you, not only to the panelists, but also to the attendees. Everybody have participated. We have seen that, I have noticed by the names that we have people all the four lectures. I hope you have enjoyed the lectures. If that's the case, I have done it. And I really hope that Yaniv, I'm very happy that you are here today. We know each other for a very long time. And I hope that we can meet again in person, and we don't do just only via Zoom. I really hope that soon we can meet, but not be as soon. And with that, I want to thank you. I think to everybody here, and also I want to use this time as well to thank you, Sais, for helping us with this course. I will take also, if Rafael allow me, 2 minutes with the students to say goodbye, because I have to leave early to another meeting in the afternoon, and I will not be able to say goodbye. But with that, I want to say thank you to everybody. Bye.